Hey everybody, Steven here. I really want to talk about a subject that not a lot of people in the Guitar Hero community or the CH community really talk about all that much. Me personally, I've never really been somebody who likes to score on my grinds, especially for hard songs, because it adds so much pressure you just don't want to miss, and going for score on top of that, you're adding a layer of nerves that just really shouldn't be there. But I've always found it pretty interesting that some people who actually go for scores, the amount of risks and how difficult a lot of, you know, scoring can actually be, and not a lot of people really talk about that. I really want to show how some squeezes can be extremely impressive and how crazy things can actually get, and some of the extents that people go to just to get a few extra points. Before we get into it though, let me discuss what a squeeze actually is in Guitar Hero. A squeeze is a specifically timed activation to try and gain as many points as possible on a chart. Some either have you hitting a note late as possible and then ending it early, or vice versa, where you have to activate early and then end the star power very late. Some of these squeezes are insanely impressive when you get to see them performed in a really hard song or on a really risky run. The first score I want to show you, which I think is probably one of the best scores of all time, is Jprez's Jordan score. Jprez has a score of 501.758, which is a pretty crazy score considering 500 in itself is pretty hard to get. Because not only do you have to be good at Jordan, and FC it on Guitar Hero 2, you also have to do some pretty crazy acts in the solo, and at the end of the solo, and also at the very end of the song, which is probably the hardest act of them all. Jprez is an extremely skilled player, and he's probably the only person that could have pulled this one off. Jprez is so confident in the fact that he's gonna remain first on Jordan forever that he put first forever in the title. That's how you know this is fucked. The crazy part is, 502k on Jordan is probably possible, but more than likely, it's not humanly possible. The fact that Jprez pulled off a double squeeze at the last act is inhumanely disgusting. And technically, you can get off another double squeeze at the second activation. Even Jprez says himself, it's 100 times harder to pull off than he did on that last activation. So, needless to say, I don't think anybody's going to be getting 502k anytime soon, and even still, I think Jprez's score on Jordan is safe forever. There's nothing really special about these first two acts. They're pretty straightforward. The first one you have to activate as soon as you get star power. Then for the second act, after you get a full bar of star power, you want to activate pretty late on that green, just so your star power will last you till that last chord, getting you the extra 800 points. Here is where the difficulty really ramps up. So after that second activation and getting that chord transition, you have to start it off on an early whammy, which is pretty hard to transition off of from tapping, just so you'll have enough star power to hit that last blue note at the end of solo C. You also have to activate solo C pretty late on that blue, and the hit window shrinks because GH2 has a dynamic hit window. My friend Pixel made a great video on the engine at Guitar Hero 2, and is definitely worth a watch. He explains what the dynamic hit window is compared to Clone Hero, and how it makes a difference on tighter engines.
As soon as you have notes on the board, however, that's when things change. CH doesn't move, no matter how many notes you throw at it, as a static timing window. All the other games have dynamic timing windows. RB3 and GH2 do it both to the front end and the back end, and for GH3, it's only the back end. So, faster than the NPS, can't hit notes late.
So now that you know what the dynamic hit window is, you can only hit that blue only slightly late. But since hitting that blue late is pretty important at the start of the third activation, it can be pretty hard to time it correctly and not miss it. Having to keep the dynamic timing window in mind while squeezing on a really hard song, while also keeping in the fact that you have to early whammy before that, leads to a pretty hard activation to pull off in a run consistently. For those who don't know, early whammy is a squeezing technique used in the older Guitar Hero games to hit a star power sustain early enough to get a little bit of extra star power. Here's a quick example of what early whammy looks like in practice.
Yes! Holy shit!
Alright.
As you saw from that D-Control clip, early whammy can be just as vital to get into a real run than any other activation, some early whammies being required to execute a star power path correctly, or early whammies to be pulled off to gain another activation in the song. After Guitar Hero 80s, the only other game in the series that had early whammy mechanics was Guitar Hero Van Halen. The only games that have early whammy are Guitar Hero 1, Guitar Hero 2, Guitar Hero Rocks the 80s, and Guitar Hero Van Halen. The other games don't have early whammy mechanics, but some have this thing called extended star power glitch, but I'm not gonna get into that this video.
Oh my fucking god!
These are some of the most fucked up activations ever performed. Because not only do you have to perform these three activations under heavy nerves, they're also really, really hard to pull off in general. The first one being not as bad as the other two, but still easy to mess up if you're not careful. You can't really hit that green late because you can't overlap that star power and bridge, because you need that star power to gain an extra activation at the end of bridge. And then after that, you have to activate at the end of bridge, just so you can get one last activation at the end of Jordan. At the last activation, Jprez pulled off a double squeeze, which is a frame-perfect activation on his part. This activation is not an easy one to pull off, and the fact he was able to get one in a run is crazy. It's extremely risky to do this too, because you could fuck up the activation and lose a lot of points. And you're already extremely nervous after Solo C, and you can hear it in Jprez's voice after he gets the Solo C activation.
Yes! Wasn't kidding, Paulo!
The fact you have to do this at the very end of the song when you're nervous as shit is extremely impressive. That's why I think this is probably one of the most fucked up console scores of all time. And when I say some of these double squeezes are frame perfect, I actually do mean frame perfect. Check out some of these other double squeezes performed by Jprez.
Give me that double, baby. Yeah, I don't think that was very good. I don't know. Oh, wait, what? Wait, did I cold flame or did I just have a good activation?
He's really high above the strike line and he uses the early timing window to hit it as early as he can, and it's literally the next frame the star power ends. So, like, some of these double squeezes you have to be pretty much just frame perfect. Look at how this double squeeze is pulled off frame by frame. Literally as soon as he hits it, like it's a frame later, the star power ends, but he gets the double squeeze. Like, that's how tight some of these squeezes are. They're literally frame perfect. See, going for these doubles takes an incredible amount of risk, but doing it on chords will give you a fuck ton of points. It's worth it, but you have to be really, really careful. It's not an easy thing to do.
God damn it! Tired of this shit!
I would be too, trying to squeeze an extra 800 points. If you haven't already, definitely check out Jprez's Jordan score. This is only one of the fucked up scores this community's done. Let's talk about another fucked up score. Guitar Hero ROXS's Fire It Up First Place. This is easily one of my favorite Guitar Hero Rock scores there is, because not only is the fact that it's on Guitar Hero 1, which is my favorite engine, the first activation is so god-awful that most people will just use star power on the first trill. Most people thought you could not get that star power, but Guitar Hero Rocks just barely pulled it off. This squeeze was found by Doughboy on Score Hero, according to Guitar Hero Rocks in the description. This technique is really weird because you have to strum the note before fretting it. In all GH games, they have some form of latency where the game allows you to hit a very small window of time to fret a note after strumming it, and it'll still count it as if it was being hit. This technique is known as extended hit window squeezing, which was coined by the player Jild. For this first act to be pulled off, you have to hit the yellow-orange trill as early as possible and then activate star power immediately. When star power is about to run out before the green-green-green-yellow, this is where the extended hit window needs to be performed. With that star power activation, you strum that first green without holding down any notes, but make sure you're strumming it as late as possible. Like you're actually going to squeeze the note, and then quickly fret the green after the strumming. This will give you enough time for the star power to run out and still hit the notes without missing. And with how hard this activation is, I'm sure after you pull it off, you're extremely nervous. And since it's at the very beginning, you have to play solo 1, solo 2, solo 3, and the outro all on nerves. And solo 2 on Guitar Hero 1 is not very friendly. It's easily missable on normal circumstances, but on a run where you're past a really difficult squeeze, crazy. Luckily, the rest of the activations aren't too bad. The outro can be very chokeable if you're not careful, because you have to activate that very late, and starting off solo 2 on a star power can also be pretty risky as well. But it blows my mind that for the longest time, nobody attempted the squeeze with the first activation. It just goes to show, no matter how old a game, new methods can still be found years later. And that's what this game is all about, pushing the limits to see what's actually feasible. And that's what this first place does. It pushes something that not a lot of people even considered being possible, but Guitar Hero Rocks literally proved the impossible. I also love the fact that he played it risky even after the first activation. He double squeezed the first part, he activated a little late on solo 2, and he went balls to the wall on activating as late as possible on the outro, which is, oh my god. If you haven't already, definitely check out this video, because it's completely mesmerizing to watch. Guitar Hero Rocks is a dedicated squeezer. Almost every FC he does is squeezed through. I admire his dedication, and you should definitely check out his channel. Check out the Fired Up first place in the link in the description. Some of these methods are just straight up goofy. Squeezing as it is already try hard enough already, and now you're adding methods that push the game even harder. The tricks these players use is just straight up wizardry, and I'm here to talk about that. It amuses me the lengths rhythm gamers will go just to make history. Just like 6-string Cal modding a DualShock controller into a guitar, just so he can FC Trogdor on NTSC and bypass the strum limit without removing the strum limit. I absolutely love the niche tryharding in this community. First, let's talk about really awkward activations. So some players will go to the lengths of getting a higher score by activating in a spot that should not be possible. Either done through tapping, and then activating, or activating right at a tapping part, and then immediately go straight into tapping. In some of the later games, even just trying to activate on a single hopo can be extremely daunting, because they can register so easily. So having to activate late on a hopo can be a pretty impressive thing to pull off. One of the examples I want to pull from is Kyle Root's first place eruption score, which is optimal by the way. Even though there are only two activations, the spot Kyle activates is just mind-boggling, because not only did Kyle have to activate late on a note. While tapping, the note was a slider note, which slider notes have this weird mechanic.
The tap notes in these games have an overlapping hit window, which makes it possible for you to hit a note that's in front of another note, causing the first one to miss. That's just the story of these slider notes. So when it gets really fast, it really sucks.
And from personal experience, slider notes are that one mechanic that ruined the whole Guitar Hero experience. They're the kinds of notes that just make you angry for no reason. Even on the easiest sections, you can just miss for no reason at all. You have to hit the notes decently early, and it's better to usually standard tap them or accurately alt tap them. There's no room for mistakes with slider notes. The slightest fuck up will result in a miss. This basically sums up my relationship with slider notes, and I think everybody else's.
No! Oh, you fuck!
Are you fucking kidding me? Fuck that trill. Fuck whoever charted it. I want to shit in a goddamn box and send it to whoever the fuck charted it. Holy fucking shit. I had two, by the way, two chokes at the fucking slider trail. Oh, fuck this goddamn song. I never want to play this again, ever.
I just want to talk to him.
Wait, why do you have a shotgun?
I just want to talk to him.
Dad, this is ridiculous.
I just want to talk to him. I just want to talk to him. I just want to talk to him.
It is not his fault.
I just want to shoot him. I just want to talk to him.
You can't shoot him.
Wait, what?
You cannot tell me that this game isn't scuffed. It is. It is scuffed. Never. I will never play this game again.
So yeah, the fact that Kyle was able to hit that slider note late and not have the game just instantly fuck him is insane. And he couldn't just lift his guitar either. He had to go from standard tapping and then back to hit the select button just to go right back into tapping. All that guitar fuckery is an easy recipe for a slider disaster. And the first act isn't any easier either. For you to get an extra star power, you have to make sure you hit the star power late enough just to register all the notes before the last star power to get an extra star power and not overlap it. And since these are slider notes, you can't really hit notes too late or else you'll just get fucked. Link to this FC will be in the description. It's definitely worth checking out. Kyle Ruth is an insane squeezer. His first Flames FC was a 990k, and the only other two people to get 990k were GGamerman and YuCogMonkey, and they have multiple FCs under their belt. Kyle getting a first FC being 990 is just, what? It's insane. Definitely check out his channel.
I'm sorry I cheated.
Okay, so before we get into the squeezing technique, I need to explain something real quick. This trick is mostly useful in Guitar Hero 2 and Rocks the 80s. Any other game, I don't think you can change your calibration mid-song. The benefits of changing your calibration for squeezing is because the hit window is moved farther back, which means you would be able to pull off a higher squeeze on the strike line. Guitar Hero Rocks has a more thorough explanation on how changing the calibration will affect the hit window.
Hero that allows you to see your hit window visually. Here's what it looks like when you have zero video lag. And to better demonstrate the point, this is what it looks like when you have negative 100 lag. It pushes the hit window up forward. The notes have less time on your screen. So the opposite is true in Guitar Hero, where you can only have positive lag. It just pushes the hit window back. So the notes have more time on your screen, or rather, they disappear off your screen because the hit window is so far back, there's not even enough space on your screen to display where it is.
So now that we know what lag calibration actually does to the hit window, you can see how useful it would be in Guitar Hero 2, seeing as you can adjust it mid-song. This allows players to get a good head start on a squeeze, allowing the possibilities of a triple or quadruple squeeze, which would never be possible under any other circumstance. I wouldn't consider this cheating, because you're not necessarily altering the game. The developers put the ability to change your calibration mid-song, so might as well use it, right? Now, this isn't the same as changing the hit window, because then you are actually altering the game files. But as long as you're not cheating and posting it as a legitimate score, I think it's perfectly fine, because having a modified hit window can make some squeezes actually possible. And if you're method hunting, that could lead to some valuable information. Tanman1234543 plays around with a modified hit window just for fun, just to see what might actually be possible. He does this on the earlier games like Guitar Hero 1 and Guitar Hero 2. Having a higher millisecond hit window to pull off some insane early squeezing, and just insane squeezes in general. Since the Guitar Hero series doesn't have negative lag calibration, there's actually no legitimate way to get a better early whammy, which is pretty unfortunate. But it's cool to see what a modified run can actually pull off. But seeing how hard this trick is to actually pull off, its use case is very small, because you have to actually play at the offset you put it at, and deliberately play with that delay, and then get back to a spot where you can pause, not drop any ticks, and then having to adjust back to playing normally again. So using the lag calibration trick on songs like Because It's Midnight aren't gonna happen. I'd wish they would, but no, it's pretty much impossible. Or is it?
Hey guys, what's up? It's Zephyr Stones here.
Yeah, it's pretty much still impossible. Which is why I think this trick is so impressive, because you can take the easiest songs and make them look like Trogdor. Like, not being able to see where to hit notes makes it an RNG fuckfest. So being as this trick is really hard to pull off, I wouldn't really consider it cheating. If it was a lot easier, then yeah, possibly. The score I want to mention for this trick is 10 man's first place on Monkey Wrench, with a score of 455,482, with a 1,400-point spread from Jprez's 4,054.82 score. I'm going to be using Guitar Hero Roxas footage, because Jprez doesn't have a video of it, and since it's on Xbox, the point difference is slightly different, but it's vastly similar. This score is so impressive, just for the fact that you have to lag squeeze twice. Once in the first act, and the second one at the last act. The second one is still the same in normal runs, but it's still a really hard squeeze to get. Tanman also got optimal on this song without lag squeezing as well. Which, by the way, getting optimal on a song isn't easy, and especially this one, considering the fact that the only other person who got it was Jprez. So you're already taking a really hard score to get, and then amplifying the difficulty times 20. So yeah, needless to say, this is a pretty fucked accomplishment. Even Tanman says himself, this is the best GH2 score he's ever gotten, and it took him over 10 hours. Imagine playing Monkey Wrench for 10 hours straight. That just sounds like a personal hell. Squeezing in itself is already masochistic enough, but adding this level of RNG bullshit, oh my god, how do you not kick your TV?
Misses. Just so stupid! I cannot stand this fucking game now. They're stupid misses! Holy shit, I didn't miss! The fucking miracle! You gotta be fucking kidding me. You've got to be fucking kidding me. What a great choke. What a great choke. Damn it! Ah! God damn it! Great choke.
Let's get right into this incredible score. So the first lag squeeze that Tanner has to pull off is on that orange-yellow chord, which then, he has to pause before the yellow-orange sustain, just so he can reset his calibration, and then try to squeeze two extra green-yellow chords just for an extra 800 points. Without lag squeezing, you should be able to get four green-yellow chords under star power. With lag squeezing, however, Tanner's able to squeeze two extra chords from that phrase. Let's compare the two runs, shall we? Now, the second activation doesn't have to be lag squeezed, but it's still a hard activation to actually get. Guitar Hero Rocks ended up trying it for 45 minutes and still couldn't pull it off, and he's actually really good at squeezing. So Tanner having to perform that first lag squeeze, which is already fucking hard enough, and then having the second squeeze be even harder, I could see how getting a run past the second squeeze could be pretty nerve-wracking, or even just take you a fuckload of time to get past. Here's the two squeezes compared side by side. Now we're in the last activation, which is the hardest one of them all. Even just watching the squeeze be performed is just unreal. Like, I don't understand how anybody can play like this and combo anything. And the fact you have two other squeezes you have to do that are extremely hard makes this even more satisfying to watch. There's literally no wiggle room for you to pause. Even after he unpauses after setting the calibration, it looks like he just barely hits those two chords. And having to pause after that orange hopo, that's so fucked up. Tanman had 20 runs there that died just there alone, where he hit both of those squeezes and had to go all the way back from the beginning. That's why I'm saying, this squeezing technique is just borderline masochistic. The dude might have some funny-ass rage reactions, but honestly, they're so understandable. I'd start to lose my shit trying to perform actually frame-perfect tricks, just for something so niche as to getting, like, 800 points. Lag squeezing this activation allows Tanman to get two extra chord notes under star power. This gets him an extra 1,600 points. points compared to GuitarHeroROXS' score. But even having to perform that last double right after unpausing and actually hitting that orange note and not missing, that's going to make you extremely nervous. I'm sure once you finally pull it off, it's so relieving. And you can definitely hear it in his voice too after he gets it. Even just the amount of relief in general is quite understandable.
Yes, it's over! Holy shit, it's over.
Fucking over, dude. Holy fucking shit, this is one of my best scores I've ever done. All fucking squeezes, bitches. Holy fuck, it's over.
I'm sure if he missed right after spending about 10 hours to get past that third activation just once, it would be a pretty good reason for a psychiatrist to diagnose you with depression. This score also got 7 stars on Score Hero, which the cutoff for that was 455,022. Tanman mentioned he had a previous run where it was 455,082, which was 60 points above the 7 star cutoff. If you haven't seen this video already, or hell, even if you have already seen it, go in the link to the description and check this shit out. But without further ado, let's see this last squeeze in action.
Yes.
The last trick I want to talk about is something called pause squeezing, which is a technique that's exclusive to Guitar Hero 1. I love this technique a lot because the way star power works, you actually have to consider losing a star power to get more points, instead of routing the most possible path. I think this makes the game more balanced in pro face-offs, just for a fact if your opponent actually overlaps, you still have that chance to get ahead. Let me explain how this trick actually works. So since you're only able to activate at that middle part of the star power bar, the game has a little animation that you have to go through just to load it, but if you pause the game, right after you get that activation, the game will just load it in the background, allowing you to activate right after you pause. This trick can be extremely useful for getting another star power and not actually overlapping. There is a catch to this, however. When you pause on sustains with your guitar controller, right after you unpause, the sustain will drop, which would be fine if you didn't have to pause on a sustain, but there's a workaround. DualShock controllers are actually able to hold sustains while you pause. So if you hit the note before and it's not a sustain, then you pause, you could switch the guitar controller right to a DualShock controller. Then, after you unpause, hit that note with the DualShock controller, and then pause right after. You can switch back to your guitar, hold the fret down with your guitar, make sure you hover over resume, spam select, press green, and it'll activate right away without dropping the sustain. But how do you actually play Guitar Hero with a DualShock controller? You can actually emulate hopos with the bottom buttons on the DualShock controller. This allows you not to actually strum the hopo, but just tap it. This can be really fun on GH1, not having to strum any of the notes, but still challenging due to the difficult hit window. Here are the controls. L2 is green, L1 is red, R1 is yellow, R2 is blue, and X is orange. Simple enough. Now the hard part of this trick is that you have to hit the note and pause immediately right after. And since the start button on these controllers are really small, it's really hard to actually perform this. I'm gonna show you a demonstration on how this trick is performed. Looks pretty hard, doesn't it? The best thing you could probably do is make sure your thumb is prioritized on the start button, and then put pressure on your thumb to hit start as soon as possible. Most paths in Guitar Hero 1 don't need this trick, and at most, you're pausing on a note that's not actually a sustain. But now that we know what this trick actually is, let's see how beneficial it is to actually perform this trick. Like not never. So you can see how actually useful this trick can be, seeing as this pause trick can actually get you an extra star power. And he just barely makes that blue note too. So satisfying. Even though this trick is kind of a pain in the ass, if you're really trying to squeeze as many points from a song, this is the way to do it. Now, even though this trick isn't useful in most Guitar Hero songs, there is one song I want to particularly talk about, and I think most Guitar Hero boomers probably know what I'm talking about. You ready to see one of the most stupid paths in Guitar Hero history? Let's talk about Frankenstein. So this path has two pause activations. And seeing how much of a pain in the ass pause activating is, you having to do it twice just to see if you can get first place, oh, glorious. And this song isn't easy either. Unless you know how to use Guitar Hero 1 hopos and you're actually good at them, good luck trying to do this consistently. Just don't suck, you'll get them down. I kid you not. There's a spot in the song where you have to activate on a fucking BPM line. At least the song's a banger though. You gotta give it that. But man, I love seeing this path get used. It's probably one of the most annoying paths to actually execute, but seeing somebody actually pull it off is one of the coolest things ever. I'm gonna be comparing two runs together. I'm gonna be using Kev's first place and an old score, F4 Phantom. This song right here also explains why I love the way old Guitar Hero games use star power, because Kev had to actually sacrifice two star power phrases just to get a better score. Like, you can't just get every star power phrase in the older games. You actually have to think about, oh, what can I actually sacrifice to get more points? Without further ado, let's talk about this juicy ass path. On the first activation, Kev activates immediately right after whamming those two sustains, but he ends up overlapping that orange sustain. But since that activation was so short, Kev's able to get an extra activation than F4 Phantom. That first activation also ends on that yellow note, which Kev squeezes to get an extra 400 points. F4 Phantom waits to activate after getting the second star power phrase, which in turn gets them to have an 8x multiplier for longer, but having less notes that are worth more under star power. With F4 Phantom's path, he only overlaps one star power, while Kev overlaps two, but they both end up getting that other star power phrase. F4 Phantom also squeezes that red-blue chord for an extra 800 points. So for Kev to pull off his second activation, he has to perform the first pause squeeze in the run, because without doing so, he'll overlap that important star power phrase, costing him a shit ton of points. But wait a minute, F4 Phantom has more star power than Kev. Isn't that bad? Well, since the notes coming up are star power sustains, since F4 Phantom doesn't want to overlap the upcoming star power, he has to stop on one of the sustains. Kev doesn't. He can take advantage of that, get the star power he needs, and squeeze even more points than F4 Phantom. Plus, this activation gets Kev more notes under star power. Plus, he doesn't even have to worry about overlapping that next star power. After both of them finish their activations, they both have the same star power, and Kev is 1,998 points ahead of F4 Phantom. So it goes to show, even though Kev overlapped more star powers, he still came out with more points. These next activations after the trills are pretty interesting. So they both whammy the first set of sustains, and then the second set of sustains, F4 Phantom doesn't choose to whammy, because he doesn't want to overlap that last orange sustain, while Kev whammies all the way up to the middle of that orange sustain, and then he activates. This allows Kev not to overlap any star powers, but this is where he has to perform the second pause squeeze, because you'll have just enough star power not to overlap that second star power phrase. But if you don't pause squeeze, you will overlap that orange sustain. And even on both players' parts, they have to wait to hit that orange sustain, not overlap it while it's still on star power. And with the second pause squeeze, it's not an easy one to pull off either. You have to hit that orange note really early to give yourself enough room to hit it with the dual shock and then pause the game. Because there's just only that small sliver of time where you have to actually hit the note and pause it. And it's a pretty forgettable star power to actually pause activate on too. This whole path is just a clusterfuck in general. After that orange sustain star power, Kev has a score of 171,814 points, which is 9,524 points ahead of F4 Phantom's score, which is quite the score difference. And that's because Kev was able to actually get an extra activation, and F4 Phantom wasn't. Alright, on to the BPM activation. So this activation isn't too hard to do, though it could be easy to lose a lot of points if you don't activate at the right spot. If you notice on Guitar Hero charting, there's these little white things on the fretboard, and those are called BPM lines. And with this activation, you can keep track of where to activate if you count the BPM measures in sets of twos, and you activate on the 17th measure. You can also focus on counting the thicker white lines in the song, instead of counting them as measures. Here's a video demonstration so you know where to activate. or if you're used to audio cues, activate when it gets close to this. You also want to activate a little bit early on that 17th measure, just so you don't overlap that star power phrase. See? Not so bad. Now, why would you want to activate in the middle of a song with no notes? Well, for one, if you activate on the notes coming up, you'll be overlapping a decent amount of star powers. And two, it not only helps by making the path simpler and not having to remember where and where not to whammy, it also makes the activations more consistent. And if you did everything correctly, you should be able to get every note under star power for the next star power phrase. Thankfully, the rest of the activations here aren't too difficult. After you get those next two star power phrases, activate right after, late on that orange note, and you should be able to pull off an orange-red squeeze right before the star power ends. Kev is still 9,000 points above F4 Phantom's score. Now, onto the last act. So F4 Phantom acted at a different spot, more than likely because he might have been nervous and didn't want to activate at the harder activation, because his FC video was from 2008, and since Guitar Hero 1 didn't have practice mode, anything could have happened. No way to practice the trill section, solo 2, just had to do run after run. Or if you knew how to make a custom ISO, you could also do that. But things like OPL didn't even exist, so you more than likely had to burn a disc and use swap magic. But I like to note the difference of how important it is to act at the most optimal spots. Because F4 Phantom's activation spot gave him a total of 49,000 points, but Kev's spot got him 51,096 points. And I find it funny, F4 Phantom ends up going above Kev's score, and then when Kev gets into the outro with all the chords, he surpasses F4 Phantom by a lot of points. So for that last activation, you want to activate late on that yellow-orange chord, and then see if you can get an extra blue-orange chord at the very end. This will allow you to get an extra chord note under star power, which is worth 800 points. This path is the reason I love Guitar Hero 1 so much, because it was its first in development and such a unique concept, that the methods to push the limits of this game are just completely tryhard. And I think it shows the most balanced playstyle within the whole Guitar Hero series. Because even on GH2, as balanced of a game that is, some players can just beat you by one-handing shit or being better at a skill set that you're not. But with GH1, the hopos don't really work, so you're at a disadvantage already. Plus, star power activations are very tight, so you're not able to double squeeze. And with the only downside of not being able to practice songs, I think it makes for a pretty fair pro face-off. But anyways, let's get down to the last segment of the video. So if you made it this far into the video, from the bottom of my heart, I really want to say thank you. This video was purely a passion project, and took a lot of work to make, but I had a lot of fun making it. And it's something we don't see a lot of video essays on. Guitar Hero really is that one game that has such a unique history, but only few little people actually know about it. And it's the history that's been keeping me on this game for years. This game has brought me closer to so many people, meeting people I've known for years, or just meeting new people in general. I'll never forget my first meetup in 2015. As soon as I pulled up to the driveway, Plumato instantly ran out the door to say hi, and I've known him for a couple of years, so it was surreal. Like, I'll never forget the time when me and Plumato drew a smiley face on Textura Couch's foot when he was passed out drunk, and we were giggling like schoolgirls. Or the time Plumato interviewed me about my dead husband, which was a meme in 2016.
Hey dude, after full interview, dude, what's going on, dude?
Yeah, he died like a year ago.
Dude, how's your husband?
Dead.
Your husband died in vain, dude.
Or me eating shit at a trampoline park, cheating on DDR at an arcade, or even just meeting a Dohu for the first time. I remember him getting out all the custom discs, and we ended up using swap magic to load them. It was a glorious time. And the person who's been keeping the meetup scene alive is a player known as KingInferno93, otherwise known as Matt Way. I've known Matt Way since 2013, and I can fully say, without him, I would never be able to go to these meetups. Hosts such as Danny Enrique, also known as Danoids, who started the 2015 and 2016 meetup. Jduran1143, also known as Jeremy Durand, he's had a couple of meetups at his place. Pixelholic, otherwise known as PixelGH or Pixel, he organized a meetup at his place, which was really fun. I had a great time. And also Texture Cow, even though that meetup ended up being a shit show, but it was still a good meetup.
Yo, Daniel Jackson, the Daniel Jackson, oh my god, dude, huge fan!
Oh, you touch my tra-la-la. Mmm, my ding-ding-dong.
But seriously though, without Matt Way, a lot of Guitar Hero meetups wouldn't be a thing, because he helps organize a lot of them, plus he's also my ride. Just recently, I had a family trip down to Florida, and by coincidence, I was really, really close to Matt Way, and for years he's wanted me to come down to his place. And also by coincidence, Gamo had to be in the same area as us, so what did we do? We had a GH meetup. If you've never been to a Guitar Hero meetup, it's honestly something you should try to check off your bucket list, because they're an extreme amount of fun. Sometimes it can be hard, like some players living in bumfuck nowhere, or you just not living near any players at all. But after me, Matt, and Gamo got together, ate dinner, and went back to his place, I was up over about 20 hours, but I didn't really want to sleep. So we went down to the 7-Eleven, close to where Matt lives, and I got a couple of 5-hour energies. I ended up having the idea of wanting to go for a 2-person optimal on onion rings. But what actually sparked this itch to go for optimal onion rings on GH2 Deluxe? Well, I'm gonna have Matt explain it to you.
So, the grind originally came from the fact that I remember back in the Canada meetup in 2017, I FC'd it on GH3, and I remember I had been trying to go for it for a long time. And I actually, back then, thought I had the optimal path, but Macaulay otherwise showed me that I didn't have the optimal path, and I was kind of like, ah, dang it. And I remember at the Daniel Jackson meetup in 2019, well, you and Gamo both FC'd on your rings. He did it one-handed on Clone Hero, and you did it on GH2, and I think you had a better path, but I still don't think it was the optimal path. And once I got the full series FC clear, I got GH2 custom set up, and I remember I saw onion rings on one of the ISOs, and I was like, you know what, let's see if I can FC this on GH2. And I also remember the actual correct path, where instead of activating on A and then activating on D, it was activating on B and then activating on D. So I said, okay, let's see how far we can take this. So that's when I started, you know, testing score possibilities by playing it on like 50% speed, activate on the first red of solo B, and then try and see if I can back end that red in the low what section. And then of course, the last activation is really a pain, because you have to activate on the orange wall of solo D, which is really, really difficult on GH2's engine, because you have to one hand that. And if you're familiar with how GH2 works, if you try and hit things too late, the game is not going to like that. So having to go from one-handing something to teleporting to tapping makes it really difficult to activate later. So that was definitely some of the motivators I had. And even beyond the 127 360 score, which is a very satisfying score because 360, which at the time we thought was 368, because again, I had tested how late I could activate on 50% speed, and I was just testing scores. And I only ever got 368. I guess I just didn't do it late enough. That brings us to the trip, right? That you took down to Florida about a month ago. And when you got down here, you were like, hey, Matt, we should like totally just do like a 2-person optimal of onion rings. And I was like, yeah, sure. So we loaded up onion rings on my CRT. And it didn't actually take that long. But the funny thing is, it took us, took you FCing it like 5 times. Or actually six times. Yeah, 6 times. 5 times of, I was going to say 5 times of not getting optimal, and the 6th time he finally got optimal. What made that so difficult was, since you have 2 players operating, just to let you know, I was operating the select button and nothing else, and Steven was literally FCing the song every single time because he was more consistent than me. What was hard about that is you have 2 different brains processing things. While Steven is playing, he's not processing mentally that he has to wait a little longer for me to press select, because he's just thinking about playing. He's not thinking about the star power aspect of it. I think one of our runs, we got like 126, like 972. We missed both back ends or something like that.
Yeah, it was fucking garbage.
I think I was giving you a little mental reminder. So I was like, wait a minute. Or hit late. Just to mentally remind you, like, oh, that's right, hit late. So that way, like, I can time the star power before you actually strum for the note, so that way you can get the flame. And it took 5 FCs of no optimal score before Steven and I reached it on the 6th. Unfortunately, we didn't get any hand recording of it, but we had a pretty good reaction.
Yeah, we ended up hugging each other. We were like, oh my god, we got fucking optimal! Like, it was so fucking satisfying to see that 72. And we were like, oh my god. Because, like, we ended up having, I think, 268 runs. And like one of them was like a miss run, but it would have been a 68.
Yeah, and I think one of them would have been a 72, but we missed a front end.
Yeah.
Dang it.
But it goes to show, like, how hard getting, like, a good score can actually be and add to an FC. Now, as I said at the beginning of the video, I've never really been the person who likes to score on my grinds, because it just adds such an unnecessary amount of time to whatever you're trying to grind, and can make it a lot more frustrating. The last serious score grind that I had was Through the Fire and Flames on stock Guitar Hero 80s, which not only added an unnecessary amount of nerves, it also made it a lot more frustrating. And the only reason I actually wanted to go for it was because I knew 1 million points was possible. On GH3, you cannot get over a million, unless you're playing it on Clone Hero, and by that I mean just barely. On GH2, all you gotta really do is follow the path, and you should be able to get a million. And that's because sustains under star power on Guitar Hero 2 and 80s end up being worth a lot more under star power. I don't want to have to restart if I forget to activate somewhere. I don't want to miss because I was trying to activate, or miss because I tried to early whammy. I'd rather just get it done and move on to something else. Just for trying to go for score, it added about a month's worth of time. But that doesn't mean I'd never get the itch to go for score. Going for score on short songs like Because It's Midnight are actually really, really fun. At Matt's place, I even pulled off a 276 run all by myself, and I tied 5th place on Score Hero. I unfortunately didn't get a video of it, but I am really happy with that score. And that's what made Onion Ring so fun to grind. It's a short song, only has 2 activations, and there's only 3 star power steps you have to remember. And with GH2 Deluxe, the outro becomes a lot less RNG, so it's a lot easier to FC multiple times compared to stock 80s. Well, let's review some of the FCs, shall we? So for the first FC, we ended up getting 126,972. Now what's so special about this score is this is the score that we found out that there are 4 more points left in the song, which we thought ended at 68, but we were sorely mistaken. Now how do we miss 400 points? So for solo B, we ended up missing that first squeeze, and solo D, we hit the note before activating, costing us 400 points, which single notes with a 4x multiplier are worth 200 points. But if you hit it under star power, it's 400 points. But we activated at the right times, we just failed to coordinate with one another. With the second score, we ended up getting 127,152. A better score from last time, but we still weren't getting the DAC down. We also activated too early as well, which is why the star power ended at 52. So we missed a total of 220 points from optimal. 200 points because we activated too early on D, and 20 points because we didn't have enough star power to finish that last sustain. With the third FC, we ended up repeating the same score as the first one. So for solo B, we hit the note too early and activated after the note was hit. And we also did the same for D. Me and Matt were getting worried on not being able to coordinate, playing and activating late. But it is nice seeing that we got another 72 score. Now we just needed to figure out how we were gonna pull off those missing 200 points. On to FC number 4. So we ended up getting 127,168. And go figure, we still weren't getting the D activation. Unfortunately, the 4th FC, the capture card started stuttering, but at least it wasn't on the optimal FC. That's the unfortunate thing about external capture cards. If they start to get too hot, they can start to bug out for no reason. And it's out of your control, but it makes the run look so fake.
I would have made millions if it hadn't been for you meddling kids.
On to FC number 5. So this FC, we got 127,364. So we actually did get the DAC this time, and I figured something out to make it a little more consistent. So instead of preparing to get into position right before solo D, I hit that last chord note, hold down green, and then right as I'm teleporting, I descend that orange blue and make sure I elbow strum as well. This gives us enough time for me to hit late and for Matt to activate before hitting the note. Both of us got pretty excited when we saw that 3 and not a 1, because now we knew that we could get 370. Two. So after 5 failed FC attempts, we finally got optimal. Both Matt and I couldn't believe what we just pulled off. But here's the unfortunate thing. Because 2 people were operating the controller, this isn't an official score. Because for the solo deact, you have to activate with the select button, and since this is on PlayStation 2, you can't activate any other way than pressing the select button. That's why having 2 people to do this optimal made this a lot quicker than we thought. So the first place for the score on GH2 is 127.360 by me, and I don't think I could probably get any higher. I would love to see a 1-person optimal, but I don't ever think it'll happen on Guitar Hero 2 Deluxe. But if you think you can prove me wrong, I have a $50 bounty for anyone who can get 127.372 on Guitar Hero 2 Deluxe PlayStation 2. The requirements, you have to do it on console, and you have to have a hands video. I'm not really worried about anybody faking this, because faking Milo accomplishments is already hard enough to do. Good luck trying to splice something with all those BPM lines, and everybody would already know you're playing with autoplay. So if you're good at Guitar Hero 2 and think you can take up the challenge, be my guest. I want to give a huge thank you to Matt Way for getting in a call with me to record his lines and discuss the motivation to score on Onion Rings. He's an incredibly skilled player. He has a Guitar Hero full series, which only 11 people have done so far, and he's actually really good at Guitar Hero 2. He's the person that really got me into scoring in the first place, and even though I don't do it very often, Matt Way loves to push the limits on what he can actually score on. Just recently, Matt got 434k on Temple of the Temple, and his current FC projects are Through the Fire and Flames and 1GH3, and with the Flames chart, his PB is 970k, which on GH2, that's pretty hard to get. He definitely wants to claim the second ever Flames FC on Guitar Hero 2 Deluxe, and also break over a million, plus get first place, beating my score of 1,014,366, which he can easily do. If this video gave you an interest in scoring, here's some FCs that I think you should check out. The first one being Cyan Crayon GH's Cherry Bomb score, where he got a frame perfect early whammy, and no one's ever done that before, which allowed him to get another activation, which ended up being a 4,328-point spread difference. And there's probably more points to get, but I'm not entirely sure about that. The second one being The Way It Ends by GuitarHeroROXS. This song has a weird path in general, but to see it demolished and score is crazy. Some of the activations you have to do are downright evil. I definitely recommend checking this one out. And the third one being Kyle Ruth's The Metal score. This score is fucking crazy. It has some of the most brutal double squeezes I think I've ever seen. As much as I would love to cover these, the video's gotten too long already, but definitely check these out. They're really worth watching. And that's the end of the video. I hope you guys enjoyed. I put a lot of work into this. Squeezing is something honestly nobody talks about, and it only became a thing when Score Spy came out. I would love to make more video essays in the future. Probably not as long as this one, but on some very niche topics that really nobody knows about. I'd love to talk about the rhythm games community, because that part of Guitar Hero history really sparked the whole Guitar Hero meetup scene. Though I won't be able to get everything accurately, I'll be able to cover some things. Or even just the meetup scene in general, what some meetups were like, some of the highlights, and really just whatever I feel like talking about. If you enjoyed and liked this video, I would really appreciate if you liked and commented on it, just so the algorithm can boost itself. You're not obligated to do this, but I would appreciate it. Anyways, guys, I hope you enjoyed the video. See you later.
990, 190. I got it from synth on video. Synth death on.